pleasure to have an opportunity to bring an outstanding person in the field of education to Salisbury University. We had a great turnout last night, and Will Richardson, our Riall speaker, gave us a lot of challenging, thought-provoking ideas related to education and technology. And what I've asked him to do this morning is kind of give you all about a 15-minute condensed version of what the group heard last night, and then we'll open it up for questions and answers. And at the end of the session, we do have some of Mr. Richardson's books here if you're interested in purchasing them. They're $26, and we're glad to take your money. So please help me welcome Will Richardson.
Thanks very much. Good morning. How many of you were at the session last night? Okay. So, like Laura said, I'll try to give you 15 minutes without talking really fast, talking like that. But I do that really well too. My kids used to crack up all the time when I started. The gist of my presentation last night and kind of the thesis, I guess, of what I talk about is this idea that social networking tools on the web are really starting to challenge a lot of traditional models of things that are in our society, and certainly pose a challenge for education right now. That I think this is a really interesting moment, in fact, for educators especially, because of the ways in which the web has begun to connect people outside of physical spaces that really render classrooms less relevant. I'm not saying irrelevant, but less relevant. You don't need to be in a physical space any longer to begin to seriously learn deeply about the things that you're interested in or passionate about. So right now you can see this in politics, you can see it in the Obama campaign, the ways that they're using social networking tools to connect people, to create groups. You can see it in media, where people are basically sharing content, publishing content very quickly and easily. YouTube videos, you know, there are 200,000 YouTube videos being uploaded every day. Which is an amazing statistic when you think about it. There's over 1.4 million blog posts per day. And you know, that really is the shift here, is that the web has gone from a read-only technology now to a read-write technology where we can post things and communicate and publish very, very easily. So media is being challenged by the idea that we're all basically reporters, journalists, and videographers just using these tools that are in our pockets right now. And they're not sure exactly how to embrace that and how to compete against that. Those models of media are definitely changing. It's not the same to be a music company today as it was even 5 years ago. Businesses are changing. They have to change in a world where basically we can talk about their products, we can communicate our own experiences about those products, and it's challenging them to rethink how they do marketing, how they connect with their customers. How many of you know what Twitter is? You heard of Twitter? Okay, so Twitter is this cool tool. I didn't talk about it last night, but Twitter is this kind of interesting tool. I'll show it real fast. But basically, I think this is an interesting kind of case study from a business standpoint. Twitter is a place where you can go and basically it's called a microblogging site. You can come here and you can post little snippets, little updates of your lives, and at any given moment. And it started out as kind of a way for people just to track one another. So they said, "Oh, I'm going out to dinner," or you know, "Oh, the dog just got sick on the floor," or whatever. I mean, things like that. People were just posting, and if you were following them, if you follow me, that's LittleRich45, that's me. If you follow these tweets, these are called, you can kind of get a sense of what my life is like, where I'm at, what I'm reading, the things that are interesting to me, the conversations that I'm in. Now, you know, that may not be interesting to you. You may not want to follow me. And I won't take it personally if you don't. But if you do, you get a sense of presence from this, right? And you get a sense of kind of what my life is like. And there are people, I mean, I don't know why, but there are 2,443 people who are following my tweets. Now, that may seem kind of weird, but imagine if I have a problem. Imagine if I have a question. Imagine if I need an answer, right? And I say, you know what, I don't know how to do this on my computer. Anyone know? And I post it, and there are 2,400 people who are watching a particular question come through, people who must have an interest in me in some way, right? Because they decided to follow. That's a lot of brain power at my fingertips, right? And getting back to the whole business aspect of this, there are now, when I come on here, or when people come on here now, and they post something about a product, you know, my computer, my stupid Dell computer just blew up, right? There are people from Dell who are watching those tweets and responding to the people who are posting that almost immediately. Almost immediately. So my point is that businesses are rethinking the ways in which they interact with customers. They have to follow the conversation in different ways. So all that stuff is changing, but our basic problem here is education is really not changing. We're pretty much stuck. You know, you can fill in the blank. Some people say it's the same as it was 150 years ago, 100 years ago, 50 years ago, whatever. I said this to Laura as we were kind of walking around here too. I'm still amazed that, you know, we have new classrooms with desks in rows. Let's not lose the irony of what we're doing right here, right? You know, you're all neatly facing me, and I'm delivering the message, kind of like. And, you know, for 150 years, this is what we've done in education. But the model has to change. The model of what we do in our classrooms has to change. And this is a conversation we've had, you know, just beforehand. I don't think schools will ever become irrelevant to our kids. I'm not suggesting that we don't do face-to-face education, that we don't have kids in classrooms. But I do think schools is going to become less and less relevant to our kids if we don't figure out a different way of doing this, right? Because this is not the way our kids learn. This is not what happens when they leave us. This looks nothing like the ways in which they are interacting and they are connecting to other people. And so unless we can contextualize that out there, outside of school for them, by what we do inside of school, I think kids are going to game us. They're going to game us. They know what they need to do to get what they need to get to, right? And I'm not asking for shaking your heads here, but I know that there are people in this room who know exactly what I'm talking about. You know what you needed to do to get the A, to get the B, to get the credit, to get the grad, you know, the certificate, whatever else. Not probably convinced that you learned that much, except how to get to whatever you need to get to, right? So the model has to change. Now, my point is that because we can connect, because we can publish, because we can communicate with people in this way, the model can change to provide more of, this is not my term, can provide more of a passion-based education experience for kids. So that they learn the things that they need to learn, that we want them to learn, in the context of the things that they are really interested in. And that if we give them more license to pursue those things that they are passionate about, that then will help keep not only classrooms and schools relevant, but it will teach them how to learn, which is where we're at. There was a quote that I read this morning, actually, by the same guy, John Seely Brown. If you're interested in this concept of passion-based education, go ahead and Google John Seely Brown. There's an article he wrote called Minds on Fire. Definitely check that out. But he basically said, look, it's not what we learn, it's how we learn. That's what education has to be about. It has to be about how do we help kids learn how to learn, not what can we teach them, right? What are they learning? Does that make sense? I'm not being real articulate about that. And I realized too, looking back on my own teaching, I taught for 18 years in the classroom. I had a really good sense of what my kids knew at the end of the program, right? I didn't have a great sense of how they learned what they knew. And that really is the difference. That's the distinction. That's the really important part that we have to help kids with, the how do they learn part. Because they're going to be expected to learn much, if not just about all, of the things that they're going to need on their own. They're going to do it on their own. They're going to have to create their own classrooms, create their own textbooks, create their own curriculum, collaborate with other people, find other mentors, find other teachers, and things like that. But they're not going to go back to school as much as my generation went back to school, right? We wanted to learn new skills, we went back to school. I'll never go back to school again, I can tell you. And I know I'm old, it's probably over for me anyway. But even if I was 20 years younger, I would never go back to school. I would never take a class in a classroom again, because it cannot be as relevant as creating my own classroom with people who are passionate about the same thing that I am and who want to learn about that thing in the same ways that I do. So that's the challenge here. right? And this is playing out all over the place. Kids are already beginning to connect to places like fan fiction, where they go and they write about Harry Potter, and they find other Harry Potter lovers who come in and share their experiences. Places like Taking IT Global, Taking It Global, which is another great site to look at, where people, if you want to help the world, you want to do some good work in Nigeria or wherever else, you can go there, find other people who want to work to help Nigeria, collaborate with them to come up with programs, to create content, whatever else, to disseminate that content in ways, again, online and virtually that we haven't been able to in the past. And so, you know, there's just all of these opportunities now learning opportunities that the education model isn't really addressing. There are information challenges here as well, too, right? Because guess what? When you're on the web, you are the editor of the content that you're reading. And that's very different from the way we teach kids. We teach kids, most of the time, we give them textbooks, we give them handouts, copies, or whatever else, that have already been edited. Someone has already taken a look at that stuff and said, yeah, this is accurate, this is correct, this is relevant, whatever else. That's not the case online. Online, I edit everything that I see. I edit everything that I read. I have to edit it. If I'm not a good editor, and I'm not just talking editing here in terms of catching misspellings or comma spaces. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about editing in terms of being the editor of the Washington Post, right? The person who reads all those articles and then says to the writer, well, you didn't quite get the other side to this. Where's that opinion? Or who is this person? How do you know what this person's credentials are? How can you trust this particular person? That's the type of editing our kids have to do. That's the type of editing you have to do right now. If you're not editing when you're online, if you're not constantly thinking and challenging what it is that's in front of your eyes, then you are not, I don't think, being a literate consumer of whatever that information is. So it's a much more active participatory role that we have to take in terms of information. And I show that site, martinlutherking.org, as kind of a, you know, shock for the shock value of it, which is a basically a white supremacist site that pretends to be an accurate portrayal of Dr. King's life and is being used by tens of thousands of kids in the research in this country. There's no question about it. But if you want another example, go look for the Northwest Pacific Tree Octopus site. It's a site that comes up, in fact, I'm going to look at it real fast to tell you where it came from. It's a site that basically is being used to make a point about information literacy. It's the Pacific Northwest Tree Octopus. It's a really sad story, actually. It's about this genus of octopus that climbs trees up in the northwest parts of the country. You can see there's a very rare picture of the octopus in the tree itself. As you come down here, you can see that the habitat of the octopus is shrinking around outside of Seattle down here. The reason is because, unfortunately, women are making hats out of the octopi, and that's kind of a fashion statement that they're making here. 25 GMT 8th graders were shown this site and asked, do you think this is a pretty good piece of research? This is something that you can trust? All 25 of them said, yes, this is a really good site that we should use in our research. In fact, some of them wanted to know how to donate to support the Northwest Tree Octopus. This whole thing is a sham. It's made up. Not true at all. There's no such creature. There's no such problem. But the point is, we look at this, and because it's somewhat interestingly designed, we believe it. That's the editing problem that we have right now, right? It's that so much of what's out there, we need to be able to edit, and we're not editing very well at all. So that's a challenge. Just the last point, teaching in classrooms are also a challenge right now, because you have to ask yourself, how much of a paper-based world are our kids going to enter into? I have a friend who calls teachers paper-trained, and they need to get un-paper-trained, right? I just tell the story about all the paper that my kids bring home and the fact that they have no investment in all that paper that they're creating. And they really don't. They do all this work, and they spend lots of hours on it, whether it's homework, whether it's taking tests in class, whether it's creating projects, whatever else. They do it all on paper, and then it comes home, and that's the end of it. In this world where we can publish stuff, why aren't we doing that? Why aren't we having our kids publish the work that they create? Why aren't they sharing it with other people? Why aren't they collaborating around it with other kids, with other teachers, with other mentors? It's an opportunity that we're just missing right now, and it's one that I think, again, is ill-preparing our kids for their futures. If we keep this paper-based world in right now. And I'll give you a good example of that now, since I see a lot of people taking notes, right, on pen and paper. There's a pen now called Livescribe. Any of you heard of Livescribe? You've heard of it, right? So you know what the Livescribe does, right? It records. You could be sitting there right now with your pen recording me, listening. And then you can write down a couple words, like when I got to this, you could say octopus. You could write that down. And then when I got to the second part, you could say paper train, right? Just take little notes like that. When you get back home to your dorm or to your house or wherever else, you can take out your notebook, take out the pen, just tap on the word triocopus, and it will replay the entire piece of content, the entire piece of my presentation that had to do with that particular part. You could tap on the word paper train, and it would jump automatically to that piece of the presentation. So, digitizing content makes great sense because you can copy it, you can share it, you can do all sorts of stuff with it that you can't do with paper. Paper is very limiting in this world, extremely limiting. As much as you probably want to, you can't search those notes that you're taking right now. You know? Wouldn't it be cool if you could search your notebook? Well, you can. You can if you're doing your notebook online. If you're using Google Notebook, if you're using Google Docs, if you're using a lot of those applications online that I really believe down the road my kids are going to be using. So that's another challenge that we have. And then I'll stand this up. I'm probably going too long, and then I'll just open it up to questions. But, I just want to also make the point, however, that this starts not with changing schools, not with changing classrooms, not with changing curriculum, but with changing you. It starts with changing you. You have to understand, you have to be able to practically understand, and by practically I mean in your own practice, understand how these types of technologies change learning, change information, change teaching, change classrooms. Because if you don't understand that on a personal, practical level, you're not going to understand how to change pedagogy. And it changes pedagogy greatly. This is not about publishing. Publishing is a wonderful thing that these tools allow us to do. That we can upload 200,000 YouTube videos with 195,000 of them being pretty much crap every day, right? I mean, that's a wonderful thing that we can share all that information. But it's not the publishing piece of this that is transformative. It's the connections that you make after you publish. It's the ways in which you use what you publish to connect to other people so that you can learn with them and from them and co-create and remix. That's where the pedagogy changes. And unless you're doing that on some level, it's really difficult for you to bring that into your classroom and prepare your kids for that world. Because that is the world that they're going to get to. That is the world. If you look at just about every one of the studies, every one of the experts who are trying to identify 21st century skills, you hear this over and over again. What are the 21st century skills that our kids need? The number one that you always hear is collaboration, right? They need to collaborate with people from different cultures, people who they don't know, in asynchronous spaces, not face-to-face, virtual spaces, all over the place. They need to get outside of the classroom. And the other one is that they need to be creative. They need to be creative problem solvers. They need to be driven by inquiry and questions. They need to be inquisitive and really become nomadic in their learning. So that's pretty much my message. The world is changing. I think this is a really big change. Sullivan, for those of you who are old enough to do that. But it is a really big shift right now that we have to get our brains around, and that the best way for us to understand for education is to first understand our own selves. Questions? Comments? Pushback? Yeah.
Educator, I really hope to get kids moving. There's a lot of new arts, different ways to get kids interacting. But with my personal question is, does technology sometimes make people regress instead of progress? Because I'll just take this for an example. This summer I worked in California, and people would call. They would call and they would ask for our physical address, and they needed it so they could put it in their GPS unit so they could come here, wherever I was in California. And I was thinking, I was like, you could go to a gas station for $2, get a map, and look this up. So are we really progressing are really regressing. I think that like atlases, there's all different kinds of books and information that's there that I don't even know if kids know how to use a dictionary anymore. So I think that like this is great, but you know, I think that there's a time and place, and I guess I am challenged by what you have to say, but at the same time, some of these tools, I don't know if necessarily kids are progressing. I think that they're seeing things at face value, and then they're just taking it as is, and, you know, we gotta be able to read a map, too, so.
Yeah, well, you know, I think that my dad is on a drive that's not in my GPS, so I called him and said, I can't find him, so he gave me another address, right, that I can put in. So, but I would push back and say, but what's wrong with that? If the technology allows me to do that, that doesn't mean that I should be able to read the map, right? But if the technology facilitates an information flow in a way that is of help to people, I think that's a good thing. I think you're right. I think the kind of underlying point that we're trying to make is that we have to balance this, right? We can't, and I'm not in any way suggesting that we just make ourselves, you know, hyper-connected digital all the time. I don't think that's a good thing at all. My point is, though, is education has pretty much got blinders on about this stuff. You know, we don't want to see. We don't, because, again, we're set in our ways. We know what works. We know what the assessments are. We know how to get over the bar. So when a lot of these technologies come in, look, I got to tell you, my kids are going to be learning a lot through their phones. And I don't know if you saw the new Google phone was just released yesterday. The iPhone is pushing the technology of phones. I'll just use this as an example. I can come in here and I can use something called Geopedia, where I can put in, I basically just turn it on, and it locates, this is the old one, this isn't even GPS, but it locates where I am, immediately goes to a Yale server that then tells me, okay, well, here's where you are, what do you want to know? You want the Wikipedia article about where you're at? You want to see what attractions there are? Any restaurants in the area? Here are the train stations that you can go to. Here's all the other points of interest. I click on one of them, it takes me to the options. Do you want to read the article? Do you want to see pictures of that place? Do you want to see other notes that people have put in there about that place? So look, from an information standpoint, what's wrong with that? I think that that's a really good thing if we teach our kids how to use it well and if we teach our kids how to leverage that. I'm not saying we get rid of books. I love books, right? But 20 years from now, we may be reading books in a different way. We had this conversation at dinner last night. Even the president of the university, she valued that for saying this, but the president of the university said that maybe in 20 years, when I say, where are you? And when I write it down, it'll be, where are you? Is there anything inherently wrong about that? Well, it's not traditional. It's different. It doesn't pass kind of like, you know, educational muster right now. But 20 years from now, I mean, look at Shakespeare. We don't talk like that, right? Thank God. But you know what I'm saying? So change happens. Change happens. Some of it we need to resist. I agree. But a lot of it, I think we have to step back and kind of say, okay, it's different. It's not necessarily better or worse. It's different. And we have to be okay with that difference. We have to explore that difference and see what happens. Yeah.
I remember you said something last night about you used to teach in a high school. And you incorporated technology. Did you say you used blogs in the classroom?
Yep.
How did you do that with state curriculum? Did you have to get permission to...
With what? With state?
Curriculum. Did you have to get permission to, like, go online and allow your students to use blogs? Because I know, like, I can think of a couple counties that literally don't have, like, they're not allowing students, teachers to take their classes into the computer lab and do stuff as open as that. So did you have to, like, fight for that privilege, or...?
Well, I'm in New Jersey, so basically, to be honest with you, when I first started blogging with my kids, I didn't tell anyone. I was flying under the radar, you know, because I blogged for a couple years, actually, and I was being subversive, right? So when I saw what it was, could do, I went to my department chair and we talked about it, kind of got, you know, squared away on that. I didn't. It wasn't that I told nobody. I mean, she kind of knew what I was doing, but she didn't really know what I was doing, so she just trusted me. Go ahead and try that. But look, at the end of the day, when I implemented blogs in some widespread ways into my classroom, where like every one of my students had his or her own blog, right? And they were open to the world, and they were expected to do everything in their blogs. We did no paper. We eliminated paper. The only piece of paper that exchanged hands in my class was the final exam, because the school would not let me give the final exam online, which I could kind of. But look, at the end of the day, I wrote a letter. I said to parents, here's what I'm doing. Here's what a blog is. here's some links if you want to go look at what the blogs do. Here's why I'm doing it. Here's the pedagogy, right? Now, that's what you have to be able to make a case for. And then once you can make that case, you have to be transparent about it. You have to get people on board. And I had two kids over the course of 4 years whose parents said, absolutely not, I do not want my kids online. And I made accommodations for them. Because they did not want their kids online. They were, you know, whatever. I tried my best to convince them, but I wasn't gonna fight that battle to the end. So I accommodated them. And then in New Jersey, there are four levels of transparency that every parent has to check off. Every parent has to check off about his or her child. And they run from no information, no pictures, no identifiers, never, ever, anywhere, to, yeah, you can tell them who my kid's teacher is, my address, you know, the whole thing. So it's kind of this range, right, in terms of how the school is allowed to post information about students, etc. And, you know, if I had parents who had checked, you know, the level below that I needed, I'd call them up, and I'd say, look, I need you to redo the form. Because this is what we're doing. And in most cases, parents were like, oh, okay, cool. Because I think they understood that I knew what I was talking about. I knew what blogs were. I said, go read my blog. You know, I've been blogging for 2 years or whatever. And then this is kind of a Maryland story, actually, I was able to show them things like the fact that when I was down in Assateague, I guess it was 6-7 years ago now, I was on the beach one day, my kids were playing. On the sand with a couple other kids that came over. My wife started talking to the mother of those kids, and I went over and just started having a conversation, and it turned to the fact that her husband was a journalist for the Washington Post. And I said, really cool. I said, I teach journalism. I said, do you think your husband would be willing to mentor one of my kids in her blog, his or her blog, you know, as they go through it? And she actually knew what a blog was, so that was, you know, really good at that point. So she said, oh, I'm sure he would. I'm sure he would. Why don't you come up and I'll introduce you? So we were literally walking up the beach to go meet him. She said, I asked her, I said, what kind of reporting does he do? And she said, well, he's an investigative reporter. She doesn't have the same kind of crown on him. And I said, why is that? She goes, well, he just won the Pulitzer Prize. And I swear, my footprints are still in the beach. Scott Higgum, you can look him up. Scott Higgum, Pulitzer Prize winning journalist from the Washington Post, mentored junior Meredith Peter at Hunter Central High School. In her blog, as she wrote a story about why it was, kind of ironically, kids don't read newspapers anymore, right? And he even came in at one point when he was in Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, doing a story on the CIA. He came in and commented on Meredith's blog, gave her all sorts of feedback, tried to give her, he actually gave her the phone number of Linda Ellery, those of you who are old enough remember Linda Ellery, and set her up with people who I never could have connected with. So, what did I do with parents who were a little skeptical? Hey, go look at Meredith's blog. Here's what she did. Here's who she was working with. Right? Or go look at the Secret Life of Reading blog that my kids did, where the author, Sumun Kid, came in and answered questions for my kids. Wrote 2,300 words in response to their questions about symbols, about themes, about characters, and all that kind of stuff. Right? If you can make the case, right, you can bring parents over. But getting a long answer to a short question, I know, I'm sorry, I tend to get over on this. But make the case and then get parents to sign on. Get your, you know, make sure everybody knows what you're doing, why you're doing it. And get those permissions that you need. And I think you do need permissions. But I think you can get them. If the pedagogy is good, if the parents understand why they should do what you're doing, they will support it. They will look at it and go, okay, you know what? Yep.
You talked a lot about kids who are connected and who are doing these things outside of school. In our area, we have a lot of kids who aren't connected, who don't have access out of school, and they don't have access in school. And I'm very concerned about the digital divide and what will happen to these kids when they grow up and how they'll be able to function. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, it's hugely disappointing. It's not a fair part of the presidential campaign right now, to be honest with you, but other events seem to have taken precedence, unfortunately, as is always the case with education. But I think that there is a need for us as educators to get a little creative. Again, we were having this conversation before. But there are 150,000 computers every day that are thrown away by businesses in this country. That's the statistic. 150,000 computers every day. Now, if we were a little creative about this, we could basically go to those businesses and say, you know what, we'll take your computers. We don't care, you know, how old they are. Because we really don't need to care how old they are anymore. As long as they can connect to the internet, as long as they can run an open source operating system, as long as the box works, we don't have to have any programs on that computer at all. We don't need Word, PowerPoint, Excel. We don't need anything but a browser. That's it, just a browser. Put Firefox and give me an open source Linux operating system on there and a connection to the internet. You can do whatever you want. We can have kids do whatever they want. They can use Google Docs to do presentations and all that other stuff. They can use Flickr and Picnic to learn how to crop photos, to do videos on Jump Cut, whatever else, right? For $0, nothing. Computer's free. Rip out everything. Everything you put on it is free. The only thing it costs is the access. Right? So in terms of getting access in classrooms, the answer's there. The answer is there. It's being done all over the place. But we're just not, I don't know if it's, we're not creative enough or we just don't have the courage, right? Where we can sit and say, no, we don't need Microsoft Office. Our kids will be okay if they don't get Microsoft Office, you know? There are a lot of school board members who, when you hear even broach the idea, well, you know what, we really don't need Office. What do you mean they don't need Office? Of course they need Office. No, they don't. They need to know how to word process, right? They need to know how to make a presentation, yeah. But they don't need PowerPoint. So, again, I think that there are solutions out there from a school-based standpoint. Now, the access at home problem, I don't know what the answer is, you know? I mean, I think we can, again, provide kids computers, low-cost computers. I think that that's within our grasp. But the access piece of it, that's a huge, huge question. We worked with one school district. I'll give you a positive story about that. We worked with one school district up just east of Rochester, New York, out in Apple Picking Country, pretty poor area, 3-mile-square district. And we actually got the local cable company to come in and put a cloud over the entire district to free, provide it to parents. Not free, very low-cost, wireless, WiMAX, internet access to everybody in the district. And that changed the game. That changed the game. Because then we were able to do some really interesting things with other businesses and to get kids who didn't have computers at home, get them computers, to add computers to the classroom.
So to follow up with that, I know there's a lot of urban areas specifically, I know Minneapolis has looked at it, to basically, what you just talked about.
I just saw Baltimore too the other day.
Yeah, so the whole urban area will have wireless access. Do you think that will then change the digital divide and at least level the playing field a little bit?
Well, look, if the access is available, that's, you have to have it. So without that, there's no conversation. It depends. You know, unfortunately, in Philadelphia, the problem has been that the cable companies have reneged on a lot of the things that they said that they were going to do. And, you know, back to what your point was, too, just to throw this out, the statistic almost floors me, but I was at a presentation that the project planner for the Philadelphia Wireless Project. And he said that when they were doing the demographics on Philadelphia before they instituted that whole plan, they found out that 1 out of 3 people in Philadelphia demographically, so if you were walking down the street, 1 out of every 3 people not only didn't have regular internet access, but get this, 1 out of 3 people in Philadelphia had never been on the internet. This was 3 years ago. 1 out of 3 people had never been on the internet. So that divide in urban areas is huge. It's huge. And those kids are not going to be able to compete as well. Now, if they have access, then it becomes, you know, that's kind of the last mile, you know. That's been the last mile problem here for a long time. How do you get the access to it? If it's just computers now, and if it's just hookups and making, you know, giving kids the hardware, again, I think that solution is within our grasp. I really do. But it's going to take some creative thinking, and it's going to take some people who really start doing it. But we did that, not me, but some people who I work with. We did that for all the youth programs and Boys and Girls Clubs at camp in New Jersey. We just came down with a pickup truck full of 20 used business computers that we had just swapped out. People, you know, who we were working with just swapped everything out. We just went and hooked them up because the local companies provided the link at least. And they were good to go. And it changes a lot. It changes a lot. You give kids access. It's a big deal right now. It's a big deal. But at the end of the day, I think there's got to be national leadership on it. I really do. I don't know how that happens. You know, in 30,000 communities, whatever it is. Obama's plan does say that he wants every child to have a laptop, but we'll see. I've been down in Australia. Their government came in last year, and they are now giving every high school student a laptop. Or actually, they're not. They're giving every high school student a desktop.
Yeah. This sort of goes with what you're saying, but I do work with a local school that
I think that there are age-appropriate ways of getting kids involved in these technologies. And I don't know if I said it last night, but I usually at some point say that all this stuff isn't a unit, right? And a lot of schools treat it as a unit. Oh yeah, we teach this stuff in the second half of seventh grade, that information literacy thing. We do that media literacy thing. We got to unit up. We can't do that anymore. This has to be K-12. It has to be just a part of the way we do our business in schools. Kindergarten, first grade teachers have to be modeling their uses of Wikipedia. Even if kids aren't cognitively ready to really understand what it is they're looking at least they'll know that they can participate in the creation of knowledge, that they can go in and be editors that way. So I think that there are ways that we can get really young kids involved. That podcast I played last night is great. You know, they can make decisions, that they can do passion-based types of learning, things that they want to learn about. Imagine a kid, I think a kid who came to a first or second grader and said, you love frogs? Let's do a radio show about frogs, right? You know, and to say, let's go. And, you know, so I think that there are opportunities to do that if they have access. You know, the other point, too, that comes to mind about the access problem is this, right? And that is, and I told that story last night, but in that really low-performing school in New York City where kids come from all different economic levels, 90% of them have these things, right? 90%. And I really believe, and again, I'll say it, this particular device is just pushing phones over the edge. If you're not familiar with what's happening on the iPhone in terms of the App Store, the different things that you can get, it's just mind-boggling, the different types of things that people are creating that, in some form or another, are learning applications. I really believe that in 5 years, every phone that kids are going to have amazing capabilities for learning, and that we got to start now figuring out what this is going to mean to us, right? How to use it. And again, we look at this as the issue because we know that there are kids who sit in class with their hands in their pockets texting answers, right? That happens. We know it, right? But we can't get beyond that right now, right? Which begs the question, what kind of questions that we're asking kids if they can text the answers?
Well, doesn't really look like down to the point of transferring from kids being able to demonstrate what they know as opposed to demonstrate that they can find out right. What they need to know?
Yeah, it's the how as opposed to the what. Right. And I said, I don't think I said it during the presentation, but when I was with a group of 10 or 12 kids earlier, I said something like, you know, I would be an advocate for open phone tests, right? You know, I mean, why not? If you can answer a question, if you're asking a question that can be answered by using your phone to get the answer to it, why not? I'm sure you're not going to like that very much, but you know what I'm saying? I mean, why not? If the technology affords that, if one of the affordances of having a cell phone in your pocket is that you can get an answer to the question like, you know, what does it happen in Montana or whatever, right? Why not? Why should I be forced to memorize that? Now, there's a lot more complex, inquiry-driven, question-based stuff that I should have in my brain and know how to do built on the content. And I'm not saying we throw all content out, because we do need to scaffold stuff in. But I think we really got to take a look at the stuff we're asking our kids to memorize, and the kids we're asking our stuff to, the kids asking them to regurgitate, right? I guarantee some of you, if you go back right now and you take that, you know, high school senior English exam, you'll fail it. Yeah, she's going, you probably did really well, right? But you go back now, that's not stuff that sticks. It's not sticky, because the only reason you're learning it is because you need to get over the bar. Right. You need to get over the bar. You need to gain it, right? It's the game. That's one of the
books I find really interesting. I think it's called Schools, The Game of School.
And like filtering, so obviously the engagement is there with the technology, and it's not, you know, you said that the teachers have less information about the technology than students in most cases. So what do you see as the big connect and like starting to change, maybe getting it implemented into schools? What do you think would
implement technology in
schools? Giving educators more knowledge, because I know you suggested them using it themselves, but what suggestions do you have for making the connection?
All right, so this is going to sound like a little bit of a commercial, but you know, I've gone around, I've been doing this 4 years. I've been going around speaking, doing workshops. And I've done probably 100 workshops, if not more, you know, going in and doing professional development for teachers. Here's how you use a blog. Here's what a wiki is. Here's how you do RSS. Here's how you do all that stuff. I've only done it in a couple instances, but I guarantee you, with all those 100 places that I've gone, 6 months later, if I go back and ask, how many people are using blogs, wiki,
uptick to maybe 10%, if I'm lucky, maybe 10%. And you'll find, if you get into the teaching profession, that professional development days are, by and large, a joke. They're not looked at as serious professional development. They're looked at days that people don't have to be in the classroom. Maybe they pick up a thing here or there. But it's not serious professional development because there's no time for reflection. There's no time to practice. There's no time to engage in conversations around the things that you're learning. Right. So here's my answer. I don't know if it's the best answer, but with a colleague, we started a business that provides long-term job-embedded professional development to teachers by putting them, immersing them into social networks. So they start in September, we're kicking off 7 cohorts, 700 teachers around the world right now. They start in September, they end in May. And in that time, they are constantly engaged in conversations around these shifts, around these technologies, around pedagogy, around how to do things. With these teams of 100 teachers, we give them some face-to-face time, some synchronous online time. We use a tool called Illuminate, which, by the way, if you haven't looked at Illuminate, you should. You can get it free. It's an online classroom. You can get a 25-seat room for free if you're an educator. So you can pull in people from around the world. You can have 25 people from 25 different countries in the same classroom space online, right? And you can talk. It's got voice, video, whiteboard. You can break up into subgroups, the whole thing, right? Point is, the only way you get people's practice to change is if you do it in a sustained, long-term way. It doesn't happen one day. Drive-by training, that's what we call it, right? It's drive-by. Come in one day, leave. The only way you get practice and change is if you can immerse people into those environments and support them, nurture their experience, try to push them, challenge them when they need to be challenged, but also hold their hands when they're, you know, freaking out. And that happens. So I can tell you, this is our second year doing it. We've done it with 1,000 teachers now. I would say 80% of them, no lie, 80% of them have a substantial shift in their practice because of the long-term relationship that they have in working with these technologies. 20% of them, you're not going to get it. But I really think that that's the different model. And you can do it. You know, you don't need me to do that. I'm glad that people, you know, use our services, obviously. But you can go to Ning.com. You know what Ning is? Ning.com? You ever heard of that? Ning.com. Go to Ning.com right now. You can create your own social network like that. It's like social networking in a box. Add water, add some people, you've got a social network around whatever it is you want. And you can add photos, add videos, just like MySpace. Add photos, videos, whatever. But it's contained, right? You can limit it to whomever you want in terms of membership. So if you're a French teacher, if you're a science teacher, biology teacher, in fact, when I was down in Atlanta on Monday, I was talking to an AP environmental sciences teacher. He's at AP environmental science, right? And he started a Ning site that now has 220 members from around the world, all AP environmental science teachers. How cool is that? A MySpace where they share ideas, they ask each other questions. It's a network, right? And in the context of being in there, they're learning good pedagogies to use these tools with their kids.
I think when you sort of think about the internet and kids getting on the internet, your mind goes to, you know, the bad places, and you have just really opened up the minds to say, wow, look at what these young people are doing on the internet. And I think that, you know, I think a lot of it is more information is always a better thing.
Yeah, and just a quick point on that too, because again, we were talking about this just beforehand, but that book by Clay Shirky that I mentioned last night, Here Comes Everybody, I think it's just such a good book because not only is it a really good introduction to these shifts, but it's a very level-headed kind of look at it. You know, there is bad stuff that comes with this. Just as now it's easy for AP environmental science teachers to get together and share ideas and share information to get smarter as a group, right? So too is it easy for anorexics to get together and share information on how to not eat very well, how to purge, and, you know, how to hide their anorexia and whatever else. And that's a negative effect. There's no question about it. In fact, he tells a story in there how one magazine actually had to take down its discussion board because it was taken over by anorexics and bulimics.
And when they took it down, guess what happened? 2 weeks later, they started their own. Right? So the point is, you know, it's not all wonderful, but on balance, I think that the opportunities, once we begin to understand them, once we begin to, again, get a practical understanding of these shifts and what the potential is, on balance, I think that there's a lot of positive things that can happen. And I'll quote, again, my hero, one of my heroes in all this, a guy by the name of Lawrence Lessig, who is a Stanford law professor, started a site called creativecommons.org, which is another site that you should all go see, creativecommons.org. Basically, if you're into the copyright intellectual property issues that are going on right now, which most higher education institutions are. you know, he said this morning in something I was reading, he just said, you know, we have a huge opportunity for good in the context of these connections. What we really need to figure out is how to make that happen. We need to figure out how we can come together and collaborate and use these tools for good. And I think it's, I do. That's, I think it's a huge opportunity that I'm really looking forward to seeing it play out. It's disruptive, it's scary, it's different, it's transparent. It's hard for a lot of people to kind of even want to go there, but I think we have to. I think as educators, we have to. Yeah.
In response to the fact that now there's so much information, I guess my question is, what is in place to teach kids to be responsible and how to discern it? It is overwhelming, and for someone like me, it's often... I don't know what word I want to use. Overwhelming. Like, I start a project and there's so much, I'm like, forget it. You know, I walk into a music store, there's too many, I'm like, I'm not even going to buy one at all. And, you know, for a long time, you know, you'd say, I know it's true, I saw it on TV, you know, and of course that's a joke. And teaching, there's a whole responsibility that needs to be taught. And is that in the curriculum? Is that, how do you teach kids to do that?
I think there's two pieces. I think there is the kind of information editing piece, that piece, the Martin Luther King piece, right? And I'll say that again. I think that's just K through 12. We can't teach that as a unit, right? We can't teach that as something separate. That's just got to be the way we do business. From the very beginning, we model the kids. Okay, so this is the website. Let me just show you how I figure out whether or not this person is someone we can trust, right? I'm going to go about the page here first, and I'm going to go back. So look, this person's only using his first name. Well, that's not a great thing, because then I don't really know who that is. I'm modeling for you how I would have those conversations, even in first and second grade, right? Anything that I put up on screen, I go through a process that just shows the way I think about it. And as we get older, as they get older, we scaffold that up, you know, then we give them exercises. So here's a slide. You tell me, what do you think, right? And we talk about that. So I think that information piece of it, again, is something that we basically just create opportunities for kids to see that and learn that throughout their career. The overload piece of it is a different beast. And the overload piece of it is something that I really struggle with, but I really do believe the answer is in having a good network. Being in a good, a trusted, functioning community of learners who share your particular interests or passions. There are thousands of educators out there who I could be listening to right now, right? But I've identified about 30 over the 7 years that I've been in this. As people who I trust, people who are constantly kind of giving me, finding relevant information, kind of sifting through all the not so good information and picking out the pearls, right? And when they pick out the pearls, they blog them, and then they come to me, right? And so our network, and I hope I do that service for them, too. You know, I'll read things and post them on my blog. So the point here is that the network is a filter of information. The network is a filter, right? We don't need to read everything. We don't need to know everything, but we do have to have this kind of capacity to share information and to filter information with other people. And if we can identify a group of people to help us do that, we can offload a lot of that work to the network. I hope that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely.
But that's not easy to do. There's no recipe for that. That's what I'm talking about, where you have to change your personal practice. You know, you have to really start thinking differently about how you do that, how you learn. It means understanding maybe RSS, which we talked about yesterday, you know, syndication. Looking at social bookmarks, looking at a lot of the ways in which people share information and do that kind of stuff. So it's much more complex than simply reading, picking up, going to the library and taking out 10 books on a topic, you know, which is the way we used to do it. If we want to learn something or become an expert, take out the books, read the books. That's not the way it works. But overload is an issue. You know, we have to find ways to deal with that.
You know, it's interesting when you use the term subversively in the classroom, because that's what I remember so vividly, and still do. I'm thinking, we're on the Tech Literacy Consortium Committee for the state of Maryland. I'm not exactly sure how many counties block blogs, but they can't get them at all during the day. And then we go down through the filter system and take a look at what people feel is just content that you shouldn't access. But during the day, you end up crippled.
Yep.
And end up having to set up a subversive sort of network of sorts that you must use outside of the system because you can't function inside the system. And I think that's probably one of the reasons why a lot of teachers aren't doing it, because they're getting blocked in so many different directions that they give up the ghost pretty early on.
Yeah,
in the bigger struggle. Yeah. And they're the ones, I think, in the meetings. I know I've heard you speak on several occasions, and the ability to get to the administrators and the folks who are setting those standards for us, because they are killing precisely what you're talking about. And that's the prime to hear you say what you say and be excited by it and realize
it's hard to do.
Yeah, I can do it at home. But I
think one of the frustrating things to me about that conversation, I'm sure this doesn't hold, I know it doesn't hold true in every district, but a lot of the districts I go to, the people who are making decisions about the switches to flip on the filter are not educators. They're services. They're people who are hiring, and they just do the blanket filter. And I've come to the conclusion, I really think that the one solution that we have that we should implement in every school district, if you want to block it, if you want to filter it, have that conversation. It's going to take a long time to change that in a systemic way, but you ought to at least give desktop overrides to teachers in every instance. You have to do that. To not do that, I think, demeans the profession. Because if you're saying that teachers can't make good decisions about the content that they let their kids see, that's highly problematic, I think, in terms of the culture that you're working with. I understand filtering. I understand why you have to do that. But teachers have to have, I think, desktop overrides. So if they go to the site that's blocked, they can just put in their login and password and that site comes up. And if they screw up, then there are consequences for sure, right? Then, you know, just like anything else. I've read two stories in the last 2 days about buses that have dropped kids off in the middle of the street, or one kid who walked home from school, no one knew that he'd gone. Well, there should be consequences for that, right? He left the building and no one knew it. Well, same thing, right? If a teacher brings in something that all of a sudden, you know, is inappropriate and it doesn't make good decisions about that, there should be consequences. But to simply say, we can't trust anybody in this building to make good decisions about content because, God forbid, there's going to something that's going to come up here that, you know, parents are going to get upset about or whatever else, I think it's hugely, hugely insulting to the profession. I got to tell you. So, but I don't, you know, that's a huge conversation, dude. It's a huge conversation. Any last questions? Is that okay? You guys all right? It's tough to gauge sometimes. People like, well, thanks very much for coming.